This Sunday is truly a special occasion for all of us. Not only do we celebrate the Day of the Lord as we do each week, but on this 15th day of August, we also celebrate the great solemnity of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, which marks the moment when Mary, the Holy Mother of God, was assumed into the glory of heaven, body and soul, and therefore, in some way, by the unique, singular grace of God, did not suffer the full embrace of death. This dogma, or core tenet of the faith of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, is one of four dogmas of the Church regarding Mary. Together, the dogmas of her divine motherhood, her perpetual virginity, her immaculate conception, and her assumption into heaven is how the Church proclaims the unique life, relationship with God, and role in the Church today that is possessed by the Blessed Virgin Mary. This week, as I was preparing for today, I received a simple request from a young man that is new to the Catholic faith. He asked, "Please tell me how we know that Mary was assumed into heaven." The seemingly simple request on his part made me realize the confusion that many have about the Assumption of Mary and the complexity we have in explaining the solemnity we celebrate today. But I will give you a try. First, people often think the Assumption is a new teaching and solemnity of the Church. While it is true that this belief was not an official dogmatic teaching of the Church until 1950, when Pope Pius XII declared it so in his proclamation, "The Most Bountiful God," I won't attempt the Latin. The belief in the Assumption and the celebration of the solemnity is not new at all. There are records of the Assumption being discussed at church councils in the early 4th century. In the 5th century, there are churches and basilicas named and dedicated to the Assumption. In the 6th century, Emperor Maurice established August 15th as the common date on the church calendar for the celebration of the Assumption. So although the belief was not established as dogmatic until 1950, this was only making official what the Church had been practicing and teaching for over 1,500 years. This is not a new belief or teaching at all. Next, it seems that people often confuse the Assumption of Mary and the Ascension of the Lord. But these are not the same. The Ascension of the Lord refers to how the Lord Jesus ascended by his own power and might to his throne in heaven, returning where he had come from. Meanwhile, the Assumption of Mary refers to the moment when by the grace and power of God, she was taken up into heaven, not on her own accord, but at the will of God. There lies the difference between our Lord's ascension and his mother's assumption, a difference that may seem small, yet is very important. Without this distinction, we could hold the wrong impression about the identity of Mary, which could lead us to wrong practices with regards to how we devotion and honor and venerate Mary, but never worship her. Being assumed bodily into heaven does not make Mary equal to Jesus. That is why we must clearly understand what the Assumption is all about, so that we may indeed become genuine witnesses to our faith to others who do not understand. We often hear, especially from our separated Christian brethren, that there is no scriptural basis for the Assumption of Mary, hence, it can't be true. While it is true that the Assumption is not directly addressed in Scripture, there is plenty we can learn from Scripture about the Assumption. First, there are two passages in Scripture that do speak directly of someone being assumed into heaven. In Hebrews, we hear, "By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death." And in Kings, we hear that Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. Everyone agrees that Enoch and Elijah were both bodily assumed into heaven, So logically, we can all agree that the same is possible for Mary. So Scripture teaches us that the assumption is possible. Second, Scripture tells us that the death and corruption in the grave are the consequence of sin. In Genesis, we hear, "Because you have done this, you are dust, and to dust you shall return." But given the fact that Mary was conceived without original sin and was sinless in life, it would be consistent with Scripture that for her being assumed body and soul into heaven would be natural and expected. So Scripture does imply that the assumption is logical. Finally, John, the one we would expect to write about Mary, given Jesus' command from the cross for him to care for her, describes his vision of Mary in heaven in our first reading from Revelation. "A great sign appeared in the sky, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars." So Scripture clearly speaks of Mary in heaven. The fact that something is not explicitly taught in Scripture would not mean that it did not happen. John tells us clearly at the end of his gospel that there are also many other things not contained in Scripture that are true. This is why we have the teaching of the church. Have you noticed that although the Acts of the Apostles is incredibly detailed in its account of the ministry of St. Peter and St. Paul, we do not read of their deaths on the pages in Scripture? Everything we know of their death comes from the early church tradition and teaching. In fact, the Bible doesn't say what happened to most of the disciples. The Bible is silent in this area, and yet Protestants and evangelical Christians accept the witness and teaching of the church that St. Peter was crucified upside down in Rome, and that St. Paul was beheaded, even though Scripture does not record these events. We also find other theological concepts that are universally accepted by Christians that are not explicitly revealed in Scripture, but have instead been revealed to us by the teaching of the church. An example of one of these concepts is the Holy Trinity, one God in three persons. We can see that although something is not explicitly taught in Scripture, that does not make it a false teaching. So if we can agree that the assumption of Mary took place, how is this crucial for us today? Why is it important for us to celebrate the assumption of Mary, body and soul, into the glory of heaven? Mary's assumption into heaven, first of all, is an assurance for all of us that we have someone who is always praying for us, who intercedes for us directly beside the throne of her Son. For Mary is indeed the first disciple, the greatest of all the saints, and the one closest to our Lord himself, as she is his mother. Just as on the occasion of the miracle of the wedding in Cana, even the Lord listens to the words of his loving mother. But this is not all, for in the assumption of Mary, we also see the promise of a new life and existence that we ourselves are going to experience in the time to come, as we will also be raised to heaven, body and soul, at the end of time when the final judgment comes, and our souls shall be reunited fully with our bodies, glorified, purified, and blessed, that we may enjoy forever with Mary and all the saints the glory and true joy of heaven with God forever. Through the assumption of the Holy Mother of God, all of us are called to examine our lives and how we are living them. Let us all, therefore, aspire to reject the path of sin, evil, and selfishness. Instead, let us look upon Mary, our loving mother and inspiration, that we may be more like her in faith, humility, and dedication to others, and love of God, and to be righteous in all of our dealings and actions for we are all called to be role models like Mary and to be faithful and good witnesses of our Christian faith in the midst of our community. So are we willing to do that? It is something that each one of us is certainly capable of doing. However, more often than not, we spend our time on worldly pursuits and satisfying our personal desires. And we fail to sincerely commit ourselves to answering God's will in our lives. Hence, this Sunday, as we celebrate this great occasion of the solemnity of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, let us all remind ourselves to be ever more committed to the Lord and to do our very best to follow the Lord and to serve Him and to live faithfully in accord with God's will in each of our lives. May the Lord bless us all and remain with us throughout this journey of life. And may His Blessed Mother Mary, who has been assumed body and soul into the glory of heaven, continue to intercede for us sinners and to be our constant source of strength and inspiration in how to live our lives today as Christians. Holy Mary, Mother of God, assumed into heaven, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death.
Thank you for joining us for this celebration of the Mass. This virtual Mass is broadcast to hundreds of people every day of the week. You know, over 100 years ago, the very first celebrations of the Mass took place on the second floor of the Glenview Public House. It's been inconceivable that 100 years later, we would be reaching so many people all over the world through this technology. If you'd like to support the ongoing broadcasts of OLPH's Masses, please go to our website, go to Give Central, and you'd be able to support the ongoing outreach of this virtual ministry. Thank you for your support. Most of all, thank you for joining us in prayer. God bless you.